heads in prayer. Lord God, I do come to you now and thank you for an opportunity to be in my pulpit this morning and to open the Bible and to preach the words of God and to instruct your people and to help your people. And Lord, I pray that our efforts here in San Pedro would be that blesses you, Lord, and is dear to your heart. And I pray when we see you someday that we'll hear those great words about well done. And so I pray now that you'd help me to be your preacher. I pray for the people that with Super Bowl coming on their screens and different things that could allure them and stray them away from the most urgent things in our spiritual lives, Lord, we pray to give us protection from allurements, and might we be focused on the things at hand, the things that matter to you, Lord. And I pray it and ask it in Christ's holy name. Amen. Amen. All right, the first thing this morning, I believe that God would have as a purpose for Bayview Baptist Church is for the members of our church to be active and edifying one another. Now take your Bible to go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. I want you to think a little bit about this morning, about edifying one another. What is it to edify? How could I do such a thing? What would be the result if I did do such a thing? In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, notice verse 8, and the Bible says, "But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet the hope of salvation. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Wherefore," in view of that, "wherefore comfort yourselves together and edify one another, even as also ye do." And so I wanted to encourage the members of Bayview Baptist Church to follow this instruction, to edify one another. The Bible says to edify is to build up, to construct, to confirm. In other words, it would do that to the brethren, would build them up, would confirm them in their faith and be something that encourages and strengthens their faith, as opposed to fighting and bickering and finding fault with one another and all the stuff that Satan would love to do. God encourages us to edify one another. In the book of Judges, if you will, in chapter 1. Amen. If you're a Christian today and you've been saved very long, and edifying is not for all the members. It is for all the members as something that can be done as they mature, but it can be done to many that are already mature. And in Judges chapter 1, if you will, in verse number 20, the Bible says, "But ye beloved, building up yourselves." Notice the building up. That's what edify it meant. It was to build and construct. And it says, "Building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost." Amen. And so again, we're instructed by Jude to build each other up in our faith. Cause each member to be strengthened by our influences in the church. Amen. That's a great admonishment. God would have the people of Bayview to learn about his ways, to understand how life can be by following his ways. Amen. His children are not like the lost children. They have another father that they follow. They have other ways that they live their lives. But God would have us to learn his ways. And to learn his ways, it takes people that are willing to involve themselves in edifying one another. And I want to encourage all the members to have that on their mind as something they would do as a Christian here at Bayview. To edify or to teach others to live for God. To learn his ways is a most wonderful desire. and a great benefit for life. When I was a brand new Christian, I didn't know any of the ways of God, but I wanted to learn them. I saw the difference between the Christian and the lost people. I'd been a part of the lost people. I was in that scene. I saw the harm and the hurt in many areas there. But I saw the Christians too. I marveled at what I saw. And I wanted to know more about it. And I'm glad I stuck around long enough to benefit from being around the brethren and learning a brand new way to live. And to do that, the members of the church have to be willing to edify one another. The great king of Israel said, and I ask you to turn to Psalm 119 and notice what David, the great Israel's greatest king, notice what he said about edifying in Psalm 119 and verse 135. The Bible says, make thy face to shine upon thy servant and teach me thy statutes. Notice he had a hunger for God to teach him his ways, good ways, ways that are beneficial and helpful in every way of life, as opposed to something that would corrupt or tear down or destroy. Take your Bible and go to Psalm 143. I'm talking about being taught the ways of God. Some of you are brand new Christians, or some of you just a year or two old in the Lord. I would only hope that you hunger for knowing and learning God's ways. I guess not everybody's that hungry. Usually Sunday school is a lower crowd than the 11 o'clock hour most of the time. And it's not just here at our church, but all over the world. Sunday school doesn't have the numbers that the 11 o'clock hour has. That not everybody's hungry to learn, but everybody ought to be. Now, I want to encourage all the members of Bayview. It's one of the desires of God's heart is that if you've been saved very long, that your walk with God influences other Christians that are coming along behind, and help them to see your joy. Help them to see the ways of God and how a person can live by them. It's not just a thought, not just a philosophy, but something that I can invest in, something that I can do. And amen. In Psalm 143 and verse 10, it says, teach me to do thy will, for thou art my God. Thy spirit is good. Lead me into the land of uprightness. Notice God's teachings are uprightness. They're good. They don't destroy. They cause life. And a tremendous benefit we have being Christians and having a Bible and having a church to come to and knowing some of the brethren that have been saved a long time and get to bounce things off of them and ask questions about their wives and their children and what do you do in a case like this and learn God's ways. What a tremendous change in life. Follow God's ways. But to do that, people have to be willing to be teachers. People have to be willing to edify. And so I'm sad to report that, and I've been in churches quite a bit in my life, and I've seen the opposite take place. I've seen people tear down the brethren. I've seen people say mean things about them or use their mouth to be vicious in some ways. And this is not what God would have us to do to make the church strong. It's just the opposite. It's to find the things that ruin and destroy and root them out, that only good can survive and flourish. And so the admonition comes to edify one another. Would you be one? You don't have to be a teacher that's really smart. All you have to do is be saved a little while. And you have been saved long enough to prove the Word of God and to put it to practice and find it to be right. And when other young Christians are associated with you, they get to see the difference in your walk because you've tried the Word of the Lord and found it to be a good thing. So I want to encourage all the members to be one that would edify. Take your Bible and go to Matthew chapter 5 and notice the words of the Lord Jesus Christ and what he said about these matters. And the Bible says in verse 19, Matthew 5 and verse 19, and the Bible says there, "Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments," notice just the smallest one, to break even a little one. And look at the emphasis he puts on the importance of that. "Wherefore, whosoever therefore shall break one of the least, commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven." So he puts a negative on there. He puts a disciplinary action on there and withholds a blessing because someone broke one of the least of his commandments. "But whosoever shall do so and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven." He said, man, if someone was willing to teach one of those little commandments and cause and encourage others to follow those commandments, he says, I'll make them, shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Wouldn't you like to be called great in the kingdom of heaven by Jesus Christ? Amen. And he said, the guy that gets that blessing and privilege is the one that would edify, one that would teach someone else the ways of God. Now, I remember teaching one of our young ladies years ago a little Bible book that had some doctrinal issues in it and some basic ways of God. And I remember my wife and I sat down with her and tried to teach her the simple basic things of God and how good it was to be a Christian and why God said some things that he said and how it would help her life. And I remember telling her to pay close attention. And I remember telling her, learn these things that I'm giving you today, because someday I would like to see you maybe teach one of the younger ladies the very things that you've learned, so that those ladies can also enjoy the kind of life that we enjoy. Now, I remember stressing that to her, and more her eyes light up, and she said, yeah, one of these days I want to do that. I want to be able to teach this lesson to somebody else. What a tremendous desire that that young lady had. And edify is a two-part effort. There's the part of the teacher, and then, of course, there's the part of the student. But the teacher should be one that has been saved for several years and has read the Bible many times. You don't want to be a novice to be an edifier. You want to have been saved several years, and you want to be a Christian that has read the Bible several times. I know a lot of Christians, and some of them never read the Bible all the way through even one time. It'd be pretty hard for them to edify someone else based on their Bible knowledge. They might be able to edify based on their Christian walk, but Bible knowledge is also a very helpful thing when it comes to edifying. So a teacher should have that. And what a tremendous attribute for Jesus Christ. To think of Jesus Christ and how everything stops with one person if that person shuts up. It just goes as far as that one person. But boy, if he can get a loudmouth in that bunch, if he can find one guy that's willing to open his mouth and take it further, now think of Jesus Christ and what he's thinking. Man, somebody else is going to learn my ways. Somebody else is going to know how to live for God. What a tremendous thing for any student of the Scriptures to be a teacher or an edifier of the younger people that are saved. One who has had some experience. One who's been saved for a while and has put the Bible to practice. One who has tried the word of the Lord and found it to be a most excellent thing. I'm sad to say, not all qualified teachers are willing to teach. I believe we ought to have more Christians that are willing to teach, to edify the brethren, to build them up, words of encouragement, words of truth, things that they know to be so. Those things, they add help to the young Christian. But not everybody that's been saved a long time is willing to edify. But I want to encourage you. You've been saved very long. And if you've read your Bible a few times, you're in it. You're in that position. You want to look for opportunity to be a blessing along these lines of being an encouragement to the brethren and be one that is willing to edify the brethren. The part two, of course, is the student. And the student is one that should be hungry. You're not going to learn anything if you don't want to learn anything, obviously. There are Christians all over the world that are just not interested in learning anything. But remember, as far as Jesus Christ is concerned, for my way, my gospel, my teachings to go out and affect other people, I need students. I need teachers. Amen. And there are students that, there are young people that just don't really want to learn very much. But to learn, you have to be hungry. And if you're not hungry, I'd pray. And I'd say, Lord, create in my heart a hunger after thy ways. I don't see the benefit, but I want to see the benefit. Amen. And become a student of the Bible. Become a student of God's ways. To see the vast difference between lost people and saved people, that ought to be a real easy thing for most everybody to see. The student must be humble. You can't be taught. If you don't approach the situation as somebody in need, it takes a humble heart to let someone instruct you. You're one of those people that knows everything, and then you can't be taught. Amen. But for a student to learn, he has to have a humble heart. He has to realize that he's not the best Christian in the world, and that there's things that he could learn, and it would be great to be a student of Christianity. Take your Bible to go to Proverbs in chapter 1, if you will. Proverbs chapter 1. We're talking about being someone that would edify one another, as the Bible says to do. Proverbs chapter 1, and notice verse number 1. The Proverbs of Solomon, the son of David, the king of Israel, to know wisdom and instruction, to perceive the words of understanding, to receive the instruction of wisdom, justice, and judgment, and equity, to give subtlety to the simple, to the young man knowledge and discretion. A wise man will hear and will increase learning, and a man of understanding shall attain unto wise counsels. To understand a proverb and the interpretation, the words of the wise and their dark sayings. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. And there's two people there. There's the wise and the foolish. And of course, you see the value of the wise. He has learned something valuable. I mean, when I was a young man, I learned a lot of things that were not valuable. I learned how to cuss. I learned how to drink, and I learned a lot of other ungodly things. And I learned also that all those things had a way of kicking you in the teeth. And you think they're going to be fun, and your lust will drive you. But in the end, it fills your mouth full of gravel, and is most distasteful. But the ways of the Lord are not that way. They are pleasant to them that learn them. So just encourage people to edify one another, to further the cause of Christ in San Pedro, and to form good where there was bad, to change things over for people and the effect that it has on community. I had the privilege of being in the Bible Belt when I was in my 30s, and I was in the Bible Belt, and I lived there. And when I lived there, it was a very strange place to be. I noticed there was churches on every other block or so. And I know it might be a slight exaggeration, but there was a lot of churches in the Bible Belt. Everywhere you go, there's a church structure. And most of them would be Baptists. Very few Catholics, very few Mormons, very few Jehovah's Witnesses. Almost all of them would be either non-denominational or Baptist, most of them. And a strange thing that I noticed, that even the lost people, the influence that the churches had on the lost people was drastic compared to where I lived. Of course, I lived in L.A. all my life, so that's a pretty vile place. So quite naturally, it was an obvious difference to live in the Bible Belt. But I noticed that lost people opened doors for women. You go to the store or you go to the gas station and you go into the little store, and lost men would be nice enough to just kind, and they call it Southern hospitality. But I'll say I believe it's the influence that the churches had on the town. People were much more respectable. People were much more decent. And there was a lot of wickedness in the Bible Belt. I'm not trying to paint a false picture, but the difference between being influenced by churches and not being influenced by churches was quite a difference. So edifying one another has a very positive, helpful thing in all of society. The second thing I would like us to know, the purpose for God at Bayview, number one, of course, is to edify one another. But the second thing is to evangelize the lost. And I know with the COVID and all, it's changed things a little bit, made it a little more difficult to do. But Jesus Christ is still interested in evangelizing the lost. Evangelizing, just a long word that talks about witnessing and telling people how to be saved. Now, God's still interested in that. You don't give your life's blood for a cause like that and then forget about it, or think that it doesn't matter anymore. It's still the heartbeat and the heartthrob of Jesus Christ to take the blood that he shed and the pain and suffering he went through to capitalize on every single soul that can ever be benefited by it. And so it is his desire, as you have heard it said many times, that Jesus came to seek and to save that which is lost. Never grow weary of witnessing for Jesus Christ. Never lose sight of how he feels about evangelizing the sinner. Tell them about the Lord. In order for you to do that, you kind of have to see the peril. You have to see how horrible it would be for someone to go to a devil's hell. For one to be cast into hell forever is a most sobering thought. When I was a lost man, I never considered such things. No one ever told me. I sure did not care. It wasn't on my mind at all. Someone mentioned hell. I didn't even know what the concept was. I had some ideas in my head, but the terror of it, the eternity of it, the horror of it, no thought about it. 95% of my life never crossed my mind. When it crossed my mind was the day that Mike Moore told me about it. He was the one. That was the time that hell crossed my mind. That was the time it was something for me to consider for the first time ever. I was in my 20s when he told me about it. 21 years as a lost person in this world, never really even concerned or knowing anything about it at all until that man came. And so I want to encourage you. It must be a thought for one to see the peril, to see somebody actually going there and to be harmed is something that would motivate us to evangelize the sinner. Maybe you could look across the room right now and look at your wife, or look at your husband, or look at one of your children, or look at a friend, or whoever might be there, and imagine in your mind eye, one day they're taken from a life of comfort and cast into a lake of fire. Imagine the pain. Imagine the sorrow and the torment that would be in that awful place for this person that you know very well, someone you care about. And you don't have to necessarily care about only the people that you know well. You can care about any soul, people that you don't even know. Jesus Christ didn't know, well, I can't say he didn't know. He knows everything. But there's a lot of people that I witness to, and I'm sure that some of you witness to that you don't know. But I don't want them to go off into a devil's hell. There are many levels of evangelizing. It's not difficult to evangelize the lost. And I don't want to make you think it is difficult. If you thought it was difficult, you might just not even try. But there are many levels of evangelizing the lost. And I want to just give you a few of them because some of them are so simple. It doesn't take hardly any effort at all to do it. And to not do it when it's so simple, it's terrible. Something that's so simple, something that could spare someone eternity. Oh, my soul. The simpler, the better, I say. And there's many levels of evangelism. Now, I want to say the one level is to know many different kinds of faith and to be able to turn one to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, even if they're Catholic. Or turn one to Jesus Christ, even if they're a Mormon. Or turn one to Jesus Christ, even if they're a Jehovah's Witness. Or a Satanist. Or any other false religions that offer no hope for eternity in heaven. It would be great if you were a person that understood the different cults and religions and that God could use you to turn people no matter what they believed. There are people that are good at stuff like that. But I found in my life that even if I know well other religions, to find somebody caught up in one of them is next to impossible to get them out of it. Very, very difficult. But for you that are studious, to you that love to learn of those things, God can use you from time to time to help somebody that's caught up in false religion. So that's one way to evangelize, to learn all the different religious things that people are involved in and give them hope. But there's another way, and that is open-air evangelizing. You don't have to learn what they're ensnared by. You could just cup your hand and quote Bible verses out. And those truths have a power of themselves. That Bible has power. And you could just open-air evangelize. Our church goes out on First and Gaffey, and some of the young men would just do that. They'd open-air evangelize and just take Bible verses and put them out. And they go out through the airs, and people hear them. You can't throw it away like a tract. You hear it. It goes in, and you have to deal with that truth. And let the words of our Savior go out into the air where others can hear the truth. Another way to evangelize is very simple, and it's the easiest thing ever. No Christian would have any excuse whatsoever of not being able to do this one. And this one is just to put tracts out any place you want to put them out, in places where you would hope somebody would pick them up and read them. Sometimes I'm getting gas at the gas pump, and I'll just leave one on the gas pump. In a place where they'll see it and maybe take it. Amen. How simple is that? No confrontation. Don't have to talk with the person or hear their excuses or anything. You just put it there and walk away. Amen. You can put tracks. I know a lady in our church puts tracks on windshield wipers just all over town. Anytime she got an extra hour or so, she'll just go out and put them on windshield wipers. Oh, yeah, every once in a while somebody comes along and says, hey, what are you doing? So, oh, I'm sorry, I was just putting these out trying to be a blessing. Most of the time, oh, okay, no big deal. And sometimes they get a little upset about it, but you just take it off. Apologize if you want to and go your way. No big deal. It doesn't get much easier than that. But the first thing I wanted Bayview Baptist Church people to know that God's purpose in this town, in San Pedro, is to edify one another. And secondly, to evangelize the sinner. Now take your Bible and go to 2 Peter chapter 3. And notice verse number 9. 2 Peter chapter 3 and then verse number 9. And the Bible says, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Take your Bible and go to 1 Timothy 2. I want you to see these verses. I understand. I know you've been told to witness. I know you've been told to pass out tracts. I know you've heard stuff like this a dozen times. But brother, it has not lost its power. It has not lost the urgency of the hour. It's just as vital now as ever before. People are still lost. People still die, and they will go to a devil's hell for eternity. And they it would be great to give them a chance to get out. 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 3 and 4. And the Bible says, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. And that knowledge of the truth is connected to all men being saved. Saving knowledge. Gospel knowledge. And most Christians know, out of all the things in the Bible they know, the thing they know the best is the gospel, because they got saved. Amen. So I wanted to encourage you to never forget Jesus Christ. One of his greatest desires for all Christians everywhere is to evangelize the lost. And then thirdly this morning is to serve the Savior. To serve the Savior. And the idea here is to let righteousness invade the land. Let righteousness invade the land. Serve the Lord. Serving the devil, I hate to see wickedness prevail in our land. I hate it. I hate the destruction. I hate the sorrow and misery and the sadness that I see in people because of the wickedness. I see the drunken crowd. Oh, they have such a great time until the next morning. Oh, I see the lustful crowd. Oh, they're so excited about running around and chasing each other and fornicating all over town. And then find out later that they ruin their lives, and sometimes unwanted children, and on the tragedies go because people don't serve the Lord. But Christians, when we serve the Lord, what we're doing is we're taking God's ways and we're acting those ways out. When I serve the Lord, that means I'm being honest. I'm being truthful. I'm being decent. I'm being nice. I'm trying to let the ways of God come through my life, my serving the Lord. I'll tell people about the Lord. And people know that I'm a Christian. I don't always say so. I've seen a lot of Christians live in such a way that people that know them say, man, that's probably a good Christian lady right there. You can tell the difference. Amen. The difference is someone who practices God's way. And that's what we mean when we say serve the Lord. It's not necessarily evangelizing the sinner. That is a way to serve the Lord. But serving the Lord is acting out his ways in my life. And those actions, other people see that, influences them, makes them desire such things. Amen. To watch decay is a tragedy to watch a peach, a good peach, spoil and turn brown and rot. I'd rather eat it when it's nice and fresh, wouldn't you? I like that. I don't like decay. I've seen rust. I've seen a beautiful chrome bumper just turn to rust. And unattended, the rust continues to get worse and worse and worse. And I know these are a foolish way to illustrate what I'm trying to say. But imagine polishing that rust off to where that chrome bumper is nice and shiny and you can see your ugly face in it. Amen. It's a lot prettier when righteousness shows up as opposed to decay and ruin. The Christian has all the abilities. The Christian has everything to work with to serve the Lord and to cause his life to be an imprint and an effective witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. The biggest fear any parent has is for his child to be caught up in some bad guy. I can remember raising a bunch of children, and I had six of them. And I can remember as my young girls got older, it was a scary thing for me to think that they would like some bad guy or make friends of some bum, you know, instead of some decent person. Of course, I was a Christian, and I took my kids to church and tried to teach them the ways of God, but that fear was still there. And all you parents know exactly what I'm talking about. You don't want them to make friends with some bad person. I am up to here with how much destruction I've seen through good Christian people that start out wholesome and clean only to make friends with some bad person that influences them away from God and ruins their life. Horrible stuff. I like it when people serve the Lord. People use their life in a way that's right and beneficial to society. Let the impact, let those ways impact society. Let them see the difference. And oh, how sweet it is. Have you ever seen, it's kind of rare these days, but have you ever seen a young man, maybe 12 or 13 or 14 years old, have you ever seen a young man deal with his mother or his father and be very respectful and humble and very obedient? Every once in a while you'll see it. I remember some friends that I had as a young man, and they were had children, two children in the home, and this was a fine Christian couple, and I got to stay with them. And boy, that young man, I think he was about 13. When have you ever seen a 13-year-old young man, boy, just getting to the place where he's going to run his own life, you know? And that when it came time for bed, that young man came over and kissed his daddy on the cheek and said, "Good night, Father." And they embraced, and the little girl did likewise. And I thought, oh, so respectful. And when Dad asked for them, they say, "Yes, sir," and "Yes, ma'am." It's so respectful. And boy, you can see how pleasant it was for Christianity to show up in that fashion, to where people would actually follow what God taught them and follow what God said, and then see that wholesomeness and see that decency. You got a lot of hope. You got a lot of hope for people that will influence the society that they live in by serving the Lord. Amen. I like those things. I think serving the Lord is a way that righteousness is pushed out and wickedness is thwarted. Wickedness is held back by righteousness. And by the way, righteousness is much more powerful than wickedness. So I want to encourage Bayview, be one of them Christians that live out the ways that God teaches you to live, and you will make a big difference in your society. And lastly is to glorify the Savior. And we looked at edifying one another. Amen. And we looked at evangelizing the lost. And we looked at serving the Savior. But lastly, I wanted to say to glorify the Savior. praise him. That glorifies him. I had a young lady come to me not too long ago and met with me in my office and said, "You spoke of glorifying the Savior. How do I do that?" And I had the privilege of telling her several ways that she could take her life and make Jesus happy. Man, wouldn't that be something? Wouldn't that be something to think that the Savior that gave his life to save me is pleased by some things that I do? Amen. That glorifies him. To glorify the Savior can be private or it can be public. If it is private, then it is someone bowing with no one else around. No one else even knows what's going on. It's private. It's where I kneel before my Savior and tell him that I like him. Tell him that I love him. Tell him that I appreciate him making himself known to me. Thanking him to include me into his family. To adorize him. To glorify him. To worship him. Amen. It's a pleasant thing to the soul. All the old body, sometimes it'll kick and scream a little bit. It doesn't want to take the time. But boy, when you can get that old body of yours to fall down and glorify the Savior privately, it'll minister to the soul. And I can only imagine how it feels to be Jesus and have someone come and say, "Thank you. I love you." I can think of maybe a daddy sitting in the chair at his house and that's sitting there maybe just occupied with some little thing, and one of his little children come running over, maybe a little girl about 6 years old, come running over and said, "By the way, Daddy, I sure love you." Imagine how he feels. Well, there isn't anything in life that's much better than that. I mean, to hear her opinion of you, I mean, you raised her, you feed her, and a lot of people don't appreciate some of the things that parents do, but imagine somebody that does. Imagine coming. I can remember going over some family places sometimes, and my wife will walk in there, and we'll be coming down the driveway, and coming to some of them grandkids will come bouncing out of the house. "Hi, Grandpa." Boy, I'll tell you, it does something to you. They don't even know how it moves your heart. They just see Grandpa and glad to say hi. But boy, just to think that they love you and that they care about you and they come out to greet you like that. Well, I tell you, those are precious moments. And may I say, if you're a child of God and you come to him like that, imagine how he feels about it. He didn't give his life in vain. He gave it. He gave it, and he got a soul that appreciated him and loved him for it and doesn't just run around and enjoy life, but come and tell him about it. Come and praise and glorify the Savior. That's why we're here. And to be here in San Pedro is to glorify the Savior. And that's a private thing. But you can also glorify the Savior publicly. You can tell people how great Jesus is. That's easy to do because he is. I'm not lying. I don't have to make up any stories. Amen. And people see you pray in a restaurant. Sometimes, hey, I notice you're praying. Are you a Christian? And you get to talk to them. You can glorify the Lord publicly. I've seen men stand out on the street corner and say, "I love Jesus Christ. He's holy. He's powerful. He's all wise. He's the best," like Brother Water, "he's the best there ever is, best there ever was, and best there ever is to come." And you'll be right. You can't overdo praising Jesus Christ. You can't raise him too high. You can do that to men. You can get him up way too high and, wait a minute, I went too far. You're not really that great. But you can't do that with Jesus Christ. He's far greater than the mouth can utter or that the mind can think or that the heart can conceive. And one day we'll get to do it in its perfection. But right now we can glorify the Savior privately, and we can glorify the Savior publicly. Not everybody's willing to glorify the Savior publicly because the lost world don't necessarily like your opinion about Jesus Christ. Sometimes they find it offensive. But that doesn't mean that it isn't true. It's still true. And it doesn't mean that I should keep my mouth shut. I still have every right to voice my opinion and to say so publicly if I so choose. So you can praise the Lord and you can glorify the Lord publicly. I think the easiest place, and I know I've said it before, but the easiest place to glorify Jesus Christ publicly is right here in our church. It's so easy. You say some truth from the Bible, and somebody with a little bit of gumption will say, "Amen, praise the Lord," and not afraid to voice their opinion in agreement with the things that are so and true about God. How appropriate it is. We give time at the church where people can come to the altar and pray. What wonderful opportunity to tell the Savior privately what's on your heart and glorify the Savior. This morning, we looked at several things about God's purpose in Bayview Baptist Church. God's purpose for this church to be in San Pedro, number one, was to edify one another. Amen. Number two was to evangelize the lost. Amen. Number three was to serve the Lord. Act out your Christianity. Influence your community for God, for right. And then number four, to glorify the Savior privately and publicly. I believe if I was God and I had a church, that's what I'd want them to do. And we saw the Bible verses. I didn't just give you opinion. I gave you the Bible verses about each subject to show that was truly God's heart. That's what he wants for his people. So I hope it'll be something that guides you a little bit, something that maybe cause you to say, "I want to have part of that." Now you take all or any part of it, and I know it'd be a benefit to you. All right, why don't we all stand? I know some of you in your living rooms. Why don't we all stand for a minute? Just almost like you were in church. Maybe you could just stand up, put your cell phone aside or something, and close your Bible because we're done preaching the Bible. Close your Bible. Maybe stand if you want to. You don't have to. If you want to sit, you can sit. But I wanted to take time, and I wanted to pray, and I wanted to ask you to pray with me, and I wanted you to think about those four things as we pray. God, what part should I be doing? Maybe I do all four. I don't know. But even if I do, Lord, help me to increase. I want to do more. Let's pray together. Let's pray. Lord God, we come to you now, and I thank you for what your Bible says about these four things that we looked at today. And I want to ask you, Lord, to put a hunger and a desire in every heart of the members of Bayview Baptist Church and cause them to see the value and the truth of what was given them through the Scriptures today. And I pray, God, that it might be an effective thing to them and not just something that just is forgot about tomorrow, but something that has a plan involved, something that says, I'll be better at it because of the message. And I pray you bless your children with the message, and I pray that it would bring forth fruit unto God throughout eternity, and we'll thank you for it. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.